Good morning and a very warm welcome to our time of worship on Sunday the 7th of March. I'm really glad that you're able to join us and you are really welcome. It's week 3 of the Saying Yes to Life course. This is a course all about creation and all about how we care for it. And this morning, first Susie and then later on Shirley are both going to help us to think about land. And I'm looking forward to another session where we're challenged and when we learn together. I hope you are too. But first of all, we're going to worship. I'm going to worship the Creator, the one who has made this incredible world for us. So before we sing, I'm going to pray. Lord God, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for the gift of creation. We thank you above all for the gift of your presence with us this morning. So may we know you close as we worship you now. Amen.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. Can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing. Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God.
Good morning, everybody. So I am outside in my garden because today we're thinking all about how God made the land. And I'm just going to read you a little bit from the storybook Bible. Then God said, "Hello, land." And there, splashing up through the oceans, came cliffs and mountains and sandy beaches. "You're good," God said. And they were. "Hello, trees," God said. "Hello, grass and flowers." And everything, everywhere, burst into life. He made buds bud, shoot shoot, and flowers flower. "You're good," God said. And they were. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't spend all of my time thinking about the fact that God made the earth. But have you ever wondered what life might have been like if God hadn't made the earth? Either we'd have to be really good at swimming and treading water, or actually we wouldn't be able to survive on Earth. So isn't it amazing that actually God created Earth, not just leaving the whole planet as water? And also the other thing that I think is really incredible is how many different types of plants can grow out of the same Earth. There are plants like the trees you can see behind me. Ooh, which way does the camera go there? Trees you can see here. They don't look like much at the moment, do they? But come the summer, those are apple trees. And we have lots of things that we can make using those apples. So there's lots of trees and bushes that produce food that we can eat. There are also trees and plants that just look really pretty. There are some trees and plants that don't look very nice. Some have big prickles. And there's one plant that I heard of that smells apparently of dead bodies. Now that doesn't sound very nice, and thankfully that doesn't grow here in England. But isn't it incredible that out of the same land, using the same soil, only being watered by the rain, and using the same sun for light, that we have such a variety of different plants. And I think, whoa, isn't God creative to do that? So my challenge to you this week is to have a go at designing your own tree. So if you had to design land and trees, what would they be like? What would grow on your trees? And as you're doing that, why not just talk to God about what you're designing? Speak to him about how clever you think he is with all the things he's designed that live on the earth. So let's just pray now before we move on. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you're so creative. We thank you that you have made plants and trees that give us food that we can eat. We thank you that you've put nature all around us. And we thank you that you're so creative and you want us to be creative too. Lord, we thank you for the land. In Jesus' name, amen.
This first song can be sung as a very personal song, I think, but it can also refer to our world, our planet, our gift from God that we must take care of. But we need God's help to do that. And the first lines are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah! Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for
for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your walk. It is a firm foundation. put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
And so, having sung and worshipped God together, we're now going to pray.
Hello, we're David and Judy, and we live in St John's Parish. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your disciples, "I am with you always." Be with us today as we offer ourselves to you. Hear our prayers for others and for ourselves, and keep us in your care. Amen.
Fill my heart as you filled the sea. Blow away the clouds that loom in my soul, and let the same breath give life to these dry bones. Envelop me with fields, wrap me in a mountain. Blow stars at me like kisses. Let me know your incomprehensible love. Explode in my heart like a comet. Roar through me like sunlight. Break over me in waves of compassion. Ravish me with your passion. Ripping the fabric of my universe, burst my straining mind. I cannot understand. Love me. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you do love us, and we thank you for your glorious creation. During this time of Lent, as we think about environmental injustice, about the problems with climate change, misuse of water, and all the other precious resources that you give us, help us, Father, to know that these gifts are from you and that we need to use them wisely and justly so that others won't suffer by our greed and our mistakes. Amen.
Father, we pray that you give the world the courage to give up war, bitterness and hatred, to seek peace. Father, we thank you for the way that the world has come together in this pandemic. We thank you for the way in which different countries and different companies are working together in order to bring forward tests, to bring forward vaccinations. And we thank you for the COVAX scheme, which is beginning to see even the poorest countries receiving vaccinations. But Father, we know there is so much more justice to be seen in this world. And so we pray, Father, that your Spirit would continue to be at work through your people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And Heavenly Father, we know that clouds loom in the souls of many. In the souls of many within our own church family, within our community. Not just from the pandemic, from so many other reasons. And Lord, we lift all those people up in prayer to you. We ask, Lord, that you will bring life to their dry bones and blow kisses at them like stars, that they may feel your loving and your healing touch. And Father, we know during a tough time it can be hard to lose sight, but the words of Habakkuk remind us of the coming of the Lord. Yet I will wait patiently for the day of calamity to come on the nation invading us. Though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Saviour. The Sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to go on the heights. And Lord, we do pray for all those living in lands where food does not grow, where water doesn't flow, not just metaphorically, but actually. Those that wake up not knowing where their meal is going to come from, those facing dangerous walks to collect water, those without safe places to wash and to go to the toilet, Lord, We pray for all those people who live in a world where the injustice affects their daily lives. We pray, Lord, for those people that they will know that you love them, that through the actions of Tear Fund and Toilet Twinning and so many other charities, we can be a part of the fig tree blooming in those places. We pray, Lord, for the way that we abuse the land, for the overuse of chemicals, for the desire for cheap food, wanting things out of season and at a cheap price. Heavenly Father, help us to have more respect for your land. And Father, we pray for all those who work the land, for farmers and shepherds, for fruit pickers. And Lord, we pray for all those affected by this pandemic, all those who have lost their jobs, for crops that have rotted in the field, for crops that haven't been planted, for the issues this is going to bring in the months and years to come. We know, Father, that as it says, I will rejoice in my Lord, I will be joyful in God my Saviour. Help us, Father, to be joyful. Help us to be joy bringers to our community.
Father, we pray that you'd give us the courage to give up our selfishness as we live for others, and to give time, care and comfort to the sick. And remember at this time those that we know are in need of our prayers. Father, we pray that you'd give us the courage to give up our fear of death and to rejoice with those who have died in faith. And once again, remember those whom we know who have recently gone to be with you.
Heavenly Father, we pray for our leaders, the leaders of our country, of our town, and of our church. And we thank you for them. We ask, Father, that they will remember that all authority comes from you. And we pray for Tom and Susie and Shirley and the music group and all those who put so much into the life and the mission of St. John's. Help us all to know that we have a part to play in supporting them, but also being active members of our community and bringing the light and life of Jesus into the lives of others. We pray for governments. We pray for those having to make tough decisions and those having to live with the consequences of those decisions. We know, Father, one day your peace and justice will flow like rivers. Help us, Lord, keep that goal ahead of us and to run the race so that when we finish the race, it will be well done, good and faithful servant. Amen.
Amen. So we draw our prayers together with the words that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Well, before Shirley speaks to us, we're going to have our Bible reading from John's Gospel.
This morning's reading is from John chapter 15, verses 1 to 11. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. Well, today we are continuing in our series, our Lent series, looking at this book, Saying Yes to Life by Ruth Valerio. We've looked at how God created light. We've looked how God created the waters. And today we see how God created the land. This is what the Genesis account tells us. God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered to one place and let dry ground appear." And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas, and God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it according to their various kinds." And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. God saw that it was good. Every part of God's creation was good. And it was valued for itself before ever man came along. Vegetation, the land, features largely in the Bible throughout both the Old and the New Testament. At times the land appears to have, and the trees and the plants seem to have, a bit of a life of their own. We read in the Old Testament how God gave his people a land flowing with milk and honey. And then the Psalms, which are just full of beautiful imagery of plants and trees and nature and mountains and hills and everything. Just a couple of quotes here. Psalm 24 tells us, "The earth is the Lord and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters." Again, in Psalm 1, a lovely picture of a righteous man. "He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither." There's another lovely image in Isaiah 55. It follows that passage of invitation to all who thirst for God and who respond to his invitation to come to him. "You shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace, and mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands." It's a beautiful picture language of nature responding to God. Maybe we think it's a bit fanciful to think of nature having a voice, almost like a mind of its own. There's a wonderful quote in Ruth Valerio's book. It's based on the work of Peter Wohlleben, who worked in forestry for 30 years and has done a lot of scientific research. And he's learned that trees are very interconnected and that they even do sort of talk to each other. Here's what he says about the umbrella thorn acacias in the African savanna. "When a giraffe starts feeding on a particular tree, that tree sends up ethylene as a warning gas to other trees in the vicinity. Immediately, they pump giraffe-repelling toxins into their leaves, and the giraffes have to move some distance away to find trees that haven't had the memo." How amazing is that? How amazing is our God to have thought that into being? We turn into the New Testament and we see that Jesus also showed a great understanding of the environment and an affinity with it. Many of the parables of Jesus reflect agricultural life. I'm thinking of the parable of the sower and the seeds, the fig tree, the mustard seed, etc. And we often see trees mentioned in the Bible. Perhaps reflecting the opposite of the trees of the field clapping their hands, Paul records in Romans 8 that all creation is groaning, just not mankind groaning, but all of creation groaning because of the travails, the tribulations that the world is facing. And in our reading today, that was the last of the great I am sayings of Jesus, spoken to his disciples towards the end of his earthly life. I am the vine, said Jesus, the true vine. Well, there's a whole sermon in this passage, and indeed I have preached on it in the past, but that's not quite our focus today. But a couple of reflections just on this passage. Vineyards were an incredibly important part of Israel's life. In the Old Testament, grapes signified Israel's fruitfulness. We read in Isaiah, the vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel. And the vine then became a symbol of the people of Israel. A great golden vine trailed over the temple porch, and coinage bore a vine symbol. So when you think about it, for Jesus to say, I am the vine, what a massive statement about himself. How significant was that? And as he continued on in his statement, he showed his understanding of just how the vine worked, the importance of pruning back the good growth to make sure it grew better and flourished more the following year, but also of getting rid of the useless branches that would never bear fruit. And of course, he emphasised the importance of his followers being grafted onto him as they graft branches onto the vine. Grafted into him as the sustaining life force, absolutely useless without him. And Jesus asks us to follow his example, to bear fruit that demonstrate that we belong to him. And surely part of belonging to him is to take the same care that he did, the same knowledge, awareness of the planet, of life on this earth. So what's our view of the land? We may have a sort of esoteric appreciation of the natural world. I think lockdown has made a lot of people appreciate nature more as we've sort of taken to our feet and walked around where previously we might have driven. And so many on social media have talked of the new places that they've discovered within walking distance of their homes and have discovered a new appreciation of nature, of the land. But what about the bigger picture, beyond our local environment? I think that history doesn't reflect very kindly on the human race in its care for the planet, particularly perhaps in the last 200 to 300 years since industrialisation. This colonisation, very often indigenous people have a real great reverence for the land and a real connection to the land which provides nourishment for them, which provides their food and their living, sometimes to the point of nature worship. Well, obviously that's not right, but equally it's not right that colonists took away the land from native people and then exploited it and the people for their own benefit. Even today, in many parts of the world, from the Americas through to the Far East, to Australia and New Zealand, there are many indigenous people having to campaign for the right to occupy the lands that really have been morally theirs for centuries. Christians were not free from guilt in this colonisation. Here's a quote by Archbishop Desmond Tutu on what happened in Africa. When missionaries came to Africa, they had the Bible and we had the land. They said, let us close our eyes and pray. When we opened them, we had the Bible and they had the land. Well, obviously there was some humour in his statement, but there's also some truth in it. There is some validity to what he said. Of course, not all Christian missionaries did that. But not only did we take the land from the people in those days of colonisation, but we often took people from the land. There's been much talk recently about slavery and the people who profited from slavery. And of course, what did we do? What did the slave trade do? The slavers went in and they took native people in Africa from their lands, the lands that they occupied, took them away and forced them to labour across the ocean. other things that are the blights perhaps of our modern life. Deforestation, so much talked about the destruction of vast swathes of the Amazon rainforest and the effect that it has on the climate. It affects climate change, destroys biodiversity, it disturbs water cycles, it disrupts people's lives and their livelihoods. And there are even human rights abuses by companies that are carrying out the work. And this is done in the name of profit. Reasons for it often: rainforests are cleared in order for people to graze vast herds, mainly of cattle, but also for subsistence farming. So there's a balance to be had there, because subsistence farming is about people just growing for what they need. It's to help to feed the people who are there. And then there are vast areas that have been deforested to plant trees for palm oil, with all of that, all the ramifications of that. Tom mentioned last week about fossil fuels, how we're still digging deep for gas and oil, when if you look around, we have renewable resources all around us, which could provide the majority of our needs. And I think the thing that perhaps my generation needs to feel most guilty about is plastics. I remember when plastic packaging first came in, it was hailed as the answer to everything. And I believe, honestly, most of us genuinely didn't know the implications of what the growing use of plastic might do to the planet. Those who did highlight it, organisations like Friends of the Earth, kind of tended to be dismissed as cranks. But plastic surely is this huge blight on the Earth. We know it now. Plastic islands in the oceans, fish and birds choking on plastic, plastic in birds' stomachs. And this is a frightening statistic. I read recently that every plastic toothbrush that's ever been made still exists, totally indestructible. You can't recycle, you can't get rid of it. They're there. Just this week, the BBC has reported that the passenger ship Marco Polo has been scrapped on an Indian beach. There are places in India and Pakistan where there are beaches that where wrecked ships are just beached, and they sort of dismantle the bits that they want. But there are huge amounts of hazardous waste there, asbestos, heavy metals, lead, plus the oil and the petrol that gets pumped into the sea while they're cleaning them out. It's a huge problem for the environment. And there was a promise that that wouldn't happen to Marco Polo. It was going to continue to be used as a ship. So we know all this is happening, but why does it matter? And why should we as Christians care? Because, you know, there is a view among some Christians that the world has been doomed since day one, and so let's just concentrate on the people instead. The great American evangelist D.L. Moody actually expressed this view. He said, "I look upon this world as a sinking ship, and the Lord has given me a lifeboat and told me, Moody, save all you can." That in contrast to the view of Martin Luther, who said that if he knew that Jesus was coming again tomorrow, he would go out and plant a tree, allegedly. That's what Luther said. Well, I don't agree with D.L. Moody. I think that we should care for the environment. Back in 2006, Bob White, who is a Christian and a professor of geophysics at Cambridge, gives us three good reasons, which I don't think have changed since he wrote them. Why should we care in the environment? Because God cares. We've already said when God made the land, he saw that it was good. The material world matters to God. He sustains it all the time. Colossians tells us he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. If God values the material world, then so should we as his followers. And if we abuse, neglect, and spoil the environment, we are damaging something that is precious to God. That's a kind of sobering thought. Then we should look after the world because God told us to. We were instructed in Genesis to be stewards of all of the living creation. We're to work at ruling and ordering creation without abusing it for our own selfish ends. By caring for it properly, we enable it to be fruitful and to play its intended role in giving glory to God. This is part of our proper worship of God. And the third reason is because one day the cosmos will be renewed and recreated as the new heavens and new earth. This is a promise from God. It's referred to in both Old and New Testaments. It's going to bring the fullness of life that God intended and purposed for his creation, a place where he himself will dwell with his people and where all of creation will worship him and give him the glory that's his due. So surely the way we entreat the environment now is kind of a practice run for how it's going to be in the new creation. And the certain hope of a renewed future creation is not a license to abandon care for this one. So three good reasons why we should care for God's creation. But what can we do? Some people would see it's too late. One of the first things that Ruth Valerio mentions in her book is to use recycled toilet paper. Bearing in mind that this book came out last year, what was happening 12 months ago as we were going into lockdown for the very first time, this rather amused me actually, because at the time that she was advocating recycled toilet paper, you can get any sort of toilet paper for love nor money on the supermarket shelves. But however, that was then and this is now. Recycled toilet paper, she suggests. And she says that every Christian household and every church should be using recycled toilet paper. Other recycled paper. If we shop around, we can find recycled paper. It's just much kinder on the environment. Another suggestion, it's something I've done actually, it's switching to soap bars rather than liquid soap. Here's a few stats for you. Liquid soap requires 5 times more energy to produce, almost 20 times more energy to package, and we use about 7 times more for each hand wash. But, and there always seems to be a but, the problem is that many soap bars contain palm oil, so we need to be careful about what we buy and try to avoid those. We need to do all we can, perhaps, to check our carbon emissions and offset them where we can. Perhaps we need to be thinking about the fruit and vegetables that we buy. I don't know about you, but nothing these days seems to be out of season. You can get any kind of fruit and any kind of vegetable, all year round. But when you look on the labels, you see where some of it comes from. It's from the other side of the world. So how far does some of our stuff travel to get to us? Isn't it probably healthier for us to eat seasonal, locally sourced, resourced, grown vegetables and fruit? And perhaps as part of that, we need to review our diet, to think about cutting down on meat products, cut down on the harmful emissions that come from the methane gases that cattle produce and so on. Perhaps we can grow some of our own fruit and vegetable if we have the space and resources to do that. And then I suppose the big thing, tree planting. We may not have space in our gardens to plant trees, but there are lots of initiatives to get going on around the world that we can perhaps contribute to, and contribute to the sort of the ongoing thing, not just about in our own environment, but thinking about the knock-on effect to other people and other places around the world, where the demands that Western society has placed on those places has exacerbated the problems they're facing of climate change. So maybe we should be doing all we could. Look up, there's lots of websites that you can look up to see where we can perhaps contribute and contribute to planting trees elsewhere on the planet. There's just a few ideas. There's lots more that you can look at, and I'll recommend that you might like to. Do please read the book. It's really fascinating, some of the stuff in here. But also look up on websites and so on the sorts of things that we can do to help the planet. So all's not lost. But I do believe we all need to play our part in reducing our carbon footprint and in supporting our government, which at long last is responding to the crisis that the world faces. So as I close, let's just pray as I finish. Oh, Father God, we are sorry for the times that we have misused your creation. And Father, we pray that you will help us to steward your world more carefully and show us, Lord, the things that we can do to help to preserve this beautiful world that you have made. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to finish with a final hymn, and this is one that the Wider Music Group has put together, and it's a well-known song, Lord for the Years. So let's worship together. Thank you.
Well, it's been another great week. So much to think about, so much to be challenged by. And as we go into the next week, wanting to follow Jesus faithfully and to love God and to love his world, I'm going to pray God's blessing over us. So, Lord, we do thank you for this time together. And as we take on this next challenge to love you and to love your world, may we each know the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the Creator, the one who knows us, the one who loves us, the one who calls us. And we pray in your name. Amen. So have a great week, and we'll see you again very soon.